The idea then took off. It started off very small. We thought a group of us, maybe 20-25 people, would meet in somebody's house. But then once we set up the campaign on Facebook and YouTube, the responses were quite overwhelming. So we thought, okay, in that case, let's take a bigger place. We found this place, and this is what gave rise to this first ever aquarium convention. Now this being our first time, I also request you to please treat us with kid gloves a little bit, okay? Do give us feedback, because we want to hold it every year, we want to hold it next year as well. So please do let us know where we have room to improve, and we will try to get that in the next year going. That said, I will call upon Tirtha.
We went to shop. Arey, cardinal, let's buy 2-3. Arey, it's very good cichlids, let's buy 2-3. Don't do that. You saw some fishes, come back home, read about it. If it is compatible for your tank or not, then you purchase. Otherwise, what will happen is that either after 7 days or after 10 days, you will lose the fish. Waste of money, waste of life. This is a kind of movement, I would say it's an undercover movement of every hobbyist, that we will avoid the deformed fish. We have introduced two fishes in India. One is tilapia, another is gambusia. Tilapia and gambusia, they both are introduced only because they breed fast, they grow fast. So unknowingly and knowingly, what we are doing is that we are destroying our own biotope, own habitat, own fish diversity. Mother Nature has given us a lot, and we do not have the right to imbalance that thing. So let's place to the non-ethical fish keeping. Let's promise today that we will be having a healthy, good way of keeping fish.
The size of the tank is very important, and it again depends on the size of the fish and the species which you're keeping. Bigger tank holds a large amount of water, and the wastage of fish is also less, and it again depends on the quantity of the fish you're putting in the tank. There are few equipments and requirements, like filter, which is very essential, and air pump that gives oxygen for all the fishes. Heater, fish cannot produce their own body heat. So how many of you know that bacteria is good in fish tanks? The bacteria converts the waste to ammonia. Ideally, it is recommended to feed your fish twice a day, so that you do not contaminate the water. And also, whenever you feed your fish, any food which is left over within the 5 minutes of your feeding, remove the food. So it is advisable to make 25% water changes once in 2 weeks. You can also do it on a weekly basis. So how many of you want your fish to make babies? These are easy to sex. They have a small thread-like thing. The males have a thread-like thing, and males are very colorful, more than females, like in guppies. Only males have very good color and finish. When they are paired, when the male and female are put together, the female develops eggs. And then the female lays eggs on a substrate, and there are two types of egg layers, substrate and scatters. So the process of egg hatching will take 72 hours, and then the fry to free swim will take at least 4 to 5 days. The tetras always scatters the eggs in a dense plantation wherever the plants are more. So substrate spawners are a little choosier about where they put the eggs. So substrate, they will choose a place where they can spawn, they can lay eggs. The female, the male and both the pair select the place, and so that they can defend their fry from other fishes. They make bubble nests. The male makes nest. Once the female likes the nest, then they start spawning. So what do you feed the small fry, the small babies? Egg yolk, right? So I use egg yolk. They need regular water changes and clean water, and different types of feed. There are a few cultures which are available with many of the hobbies now who are breeding their fish, and like microworms, which is one of the main like.
Okay, Sriram, happens to be a world 37 ranked aquascaper. That obviously means that he has won every Indian contest for the last 2 years, which he has. So one more round of applause for Sriram.
So right now I am using today is a guiding rocks, guiding stones, whatever they call. These rocks got very good guide. So first of all, what we need to see is we need to set up, we need to use those rocks in such a way, the biggest rock to smallest rock. Look at these rocks. It is a lot of character. You can see there is like a big rock, so your eyesight directly go to that, so it will attract your vision. Leave any gaps, once you fill your tank, all the substrate will go. This will break. So this leaf structure is much more smaller. So it will add more depth to the tank. So that is the reason I put hair brush on top. So it will create a lot of depth. I always choose fineling plants just to create depth, like if you are making a scenery kind of thing.
Why not call Mr. Bharadwaj Kota, who has been doing this for a long, long time, to give us some understanding on lighting, fertilizers, what needs to be done?
The two things which are essential for planted tank are fertilizers and lighting. Even if you have single plant in your tank, it requires all the range of nutrients like lighting, macro, micro, which I'll be explaining to you. Basically, there are only two types of nutrients. The nutrients which are required for the plant in larger quantities are called macronutrients, and the nutrients which are required for the plant in smaller quantities are micronutrients. Again, in macronutrients, some nutrients are not available in the water, which we need to provide. Some nutrients are available. For example, nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium needs to be supplemented. Rest of the macronutrients like calcium, sulfur, magnesium, silicon, chlorine, carbon, hydrogen and oxygen are already available. How do we dose the fertilizers? There is a simple method called estimative index. What this estimative index does is, in a planted tank environment, it gives up all the nutrients which are required by the plant. What we need to do is, we need to dose the nutrients every day. There is a large water change, we do at end of the week so that all the nutrients come into that required position again. If you have red plants in your tank, what you need to do is you need to give them additional iron. You need to have good circulation throughout the tank, because the nutrients which you dose should reach all the corners of the tank so that the plants will take it. Dosing the nutrients, you just need to maintain the levels. How you dose, when you dose, it's not much important. These are just guidance, these are not rules. Always the nutrients and lighting go hand in hand. There are seven colors in the spectrum, but most of the plants uses only two colors in that. That is blue and red. Blue in high quantities, after that comes red. Whatever may be the light, you should give the spectrum. If you have a plant, you should have two things minimum. You need to use 6500 Kelvin light, and you need to use macro and micronutrients. What should be the intensity of the light? As I said, both we need quality and quantity of light. LED, what I do is, for every cubic feet of water in the tank, I use 20 watt.
Because direct sunlight, you cannot compare this thing with any kind of other artificial light what we use. It is very high intensity.
For this session, I'm going to call Siddharth. Now, Siddharth happens to be an MS in orthopedics, if I am correct. But that's just something he does to probably earn money. What he actually does is keep Discus. He has got the largest Discus tank probably in the whole city. And he has been doing it, I mean, for ages. So I'll have Siddharth, please come in.
Why discuss Discus? So Discus are considered to be the king of freshwater aquarium. They are considered to be the crowning jewel of the hobby. They are very beautiful and majestic. They are very colorful. They have a wide range of options to choose from. And many people love the challenge of keeping Discus. There are two types of Discus. The wild Discus which are found in Amazon, and the domestic Discus which I have been breeding selectively since the last couple of decades. This is a pic showing heckled discus. This is one of the most popular types of discus we keep, but they are supposedly harder to keep than every other kind of discus. They have very prominent vertical bar in the middle of the body, but the domestic discus, they are adjusted to most of the water conditions here, and you can keep pretty much in any local water, even tap water or groundwater, you can keep the regular discus. Tank requirements. Discus are relatively large fish. They grow to at least 6 inches by the time they mature. The larger ones can be nearly 10 inches or more. So they need a pretty good tank space for them to roam around and thrive in the tank. Ideally, it is recommended to keep one discus for every 10 gallons of water. The another important thing is, when you want to keep discus, you have to buy good quality fish. There's no point in buying poor quality fish or unhealthy fish and trying hard to get them back to shape. Always buy good quality fish so that you have less problems. Because by changing water alone, you'll be tired and fed up by keeping discus. You should avoid stunted fish. How to avoid is, you have to look at the eye to body ratio. They should have small eyes in comparison to body. This is a very good quality fish. You can see the eye is small in comparison to the body. If you stack the size vertically from up to down, you should be able to stack at least 6 in a good quality discus. This is a perfect example of a stunted discus. These are commonly seen in our local stalls here. They'll be sold for cheap, but they will never turn out to be round. They will never grow out properly, and they will probably die in the first month or so. But the important thing to do is to give a wide range of foods, to mix different kinds of food so that they'll have a balanced nutrition. But discus being an expensive fish, and because we put a lot of effort in keeping this fish, it's better to follow a few things like quarantine while adding new fish to our tank. The problem with adding new fish is it might have any disease which can spread to a fish that we already have in our tanks. Compatible plants, because of this condition, the points I just mentioned, all plants will not do well in a discus tank. These plants mentioned here can adjust to the high temperature easily and can and most of these plants are low maintenance. The common plants like anubias, java ferns, valley snaria, cryptocorn, swarts, etc. All floating plants can be kept easily. And coming to the breeding, good food, clean water, and a good maintenance by doing regular water changes will result in healthy fish, and the discus will spawn. The first discus tank, what do you need? The minimum requirements, like we talked about, the tank size should be at least 50 gallon, that is a 3-footer, 3 feet by 1.5 by 1.5, to keep a group of 5 discus. So, 1 discus for 10 gallons, so we can keep a group of 5 discus in this. Decor, start with the bare bottom tank because it will be easy to maintain. Pick and choose 5 healthy discus. And adults are very easy to keep. If you want to start keeping discus, start with adults. Even if they are a little expensive, they'll be very forgiving. They won't end up sick. You need to do less water changes and they look good. And you don't need to worry about stunting them or ending up with bad quality fish or food. A combination of the good quality pellets like tetra baits or anything higher will be enough. And feed them multiple times a day. Adult fish can be fed 1 or 2 times a day, but the young fish must be fed 4 to 6 times a day. This is the most important thing. Whatever you do, whatever setup you keep discussing, water changes are a must. These are not forgiving when keeping, discus are not forgiving in relation to the water quality. If you do water changes, you'll have healthy fish. Otherwise, you'll definitely end up losing them or they will become stunted. So do at least 50% water changes per week for adults and do daily water changes for young fish.
Hamza is also quite a famous aquascaper. He is also an international rank holder. So we have 2 international rank holders in our midst today, Sriram and Hamza. So he was placed 3rd in the biotope aquarium design contest in the Asian biotope category. And he also finished in the top 10 in the Aquatic Gardens Association biotope category. Hamza.
Good afternoon. So we are going to start our second session of aquascaping demo. I have chosen to use some dress code along with rocks this time. I usually do aquascaping in a very organized manner. I sketch one, then I get the picture in my mind that I want to create in an aquarium. So I'll begin by just positioning the boat first. A bit of trimming here. Basically, I'll take this out. By adding a bit of substrate, you can avoid scratches on the bottom of your plant. To have the right thing. Based on the rules of rule of thirds, I'm trying to lay the focal point. Focal point which is actually a basic principle in photography and art. It is applied over here as well. While doing this, you must make sure that your hardscape is sturdy enough so that it won't fall over when you are planting. Right now, dampening the substrate, the top layer of the substrate won't roll down over that. The rolling will be minimized by using a bit of water. Okay, the scape is done.
Whoa.
It doesn't have a look at it.
call Teertha to take a session on aquarium lighting and photography. So, to give you a brief on Teertha, he is an avid fish keeper and he also happens to be the founder of Kolkata Aquarium Club. So, please a big hand for that.
What exactly it takes to click a good picture of the aquarium as well as for the fishes. So the basic and foremost thing needs for the photography is light. If I have more light, my subject will be well lit, my subject will be visible in a more balanced way with a more details. Sometimes what we feel is that when you take the picture at night or the dark time, it takes long time to capture and most of the time our pictures are coming blur. Why? Because of this low shutter speed. The moment we are putting more light on the tank or more light on the subject, shutter speed will be automatically high. Let me just go through the basics. So there are other than photographical instrument, other than light, other than camera, there are few things we keep on messing up. And that is something that is a very easy thing what we can take here. And it's a better, if you want to take a better picture, it's better we follow. So the thing is that photography, so be it an aquarium picture, be it a fish picture, be it a bird, be it a landscape, you cannot do that thing in a hurry. You need time. It is not something that I will come down, I will spend 20 minutes of time over there, I will get the photograph and I will go. No, it's not that. So before we take a beautiful picture of our tank, we have to make the tank beautiful first. The day you will be taking the photograph, make sure you are doing a very large water change before that. Instant, some water pollution. So this is something that I would say that normal, while we are doing the aquarium maintenance, it's not required. But when we are trying to get some good picture, I think it's time we use this. Another is the water pollution. Water pollution is nothing but a very fine synthetic filter medium. What it will do is that the moment the water circulation starts, power filter will suck the water. So the water will pass through that filter medium and very minute, which is not even visible for the eyes, those particles will be captured into that medium. Wait for the night, so you will not get unnecessary lights coming and unnecessary reflection from your subject when you are aquarium. Feed your fishes at least 2 hours before, at least. If you forget feeding, do not feed them, they will not die for a night. Remove your filter, remove your hose. Do not feed the fish and all this clean and clear tank. Get a good sturdy tripod. So this is what I am saying is about the aquarium photography, not the fish photography. It's glass. Inside there is water. So whatever we are seeing, it is not the real picture inside. There are, so whenever you are just keeping the camera in an angle, diffraction, it will distort the things. First distortion point is that the glass, second distortion point is the water. If you keep the camera straight, always hold the camera like this. So, while taking a photo, don't do it like this, don't do it like this. Always keep it like this. So straight, this and this will be parallel. Less reflection, less refraction. You do not need a DSLR to take a good picture. Nowadays the point and shoot is coming with all the features. Instead of getting into the too much of technical stuff, what I will say is that keep your aperture value low, that means the camera's lens will be wide open. Depth of field will be very shallow. While you are taking the aquarium picture, don't go for a lesser air value. In SLR, in point and shoot, you can find this air value in every board easily. Let's say I am taking a huge tank where I do not have too much of light. There are dark areas. Higher F value means, but higher aperture means shutter speed will go down. So you will be getting blurry picture. How you can increase that shutter count? You have to increase the ISO. Do not use the on-camera flash. No flash is required. Whatever the light you want to give from the top, not from the front, not from the back. There are a basic difference between an aquarium photography and fish photography. Aquarium doesn't move, fish moves. So the best thing is that for fish photography is that you maintain a good distance.
don't let your fish see that someone is trying to creep into my tank and they are trying to take the photo. Let them do whatever they want. So there are two things what it will do. First thing is that they will not be afraid. Second thing is that if they do not know that you are there in front of the tank, they will come up with their natural behavior. So if you are using a zooming feature of the use F8 safest bet. From my experience I found, let's say I am picking the tank with a single light. So I want my fishes to come into the light zone. I am waiting. Okay, I have very powerful light, but I have only one light. It's fine. Well then, put that thing in the middle of the tank. Wait for the fish to come into under the light. Okay, the best zone is this. They are swimming, middle of the tank. Take the picture. Not too low, not too high. Don't lose hope. The thing is that I would say the pictures you are seeing here or the pictures you are seeing on net, it is the result of 100 or 150 times of failure.
Next is the hardscape challenge, in which 8 participants will be selected randomly through a draw, in which there will be 2 batches. That means we have 4 tanks. That means 4 participants will be doing the hardscape within 15 minutes. And those tanks will be judged by Hamza and Sriram. And after that, the winner will be declared. Okay, all 4 candidates are ready. Your time period is 15 minutes. You cannot break any rocks. Okay, so you have to choose your rocks accordingly. Okay,
okay.
Okay, let's start. Let's
start now.
Part of it. We hope to see you again next year. Thank you.